I just wanted to say hi and thank you for choosing me as your person who's going to help you get through the Medicare enrollment process. So obviously you know me, but my name's Anthony Maritato. I go by Tony. And in this video, I want to share a couple of the pitfalls that I see clinicians run into when they're specifically trying to become contracted providers, either as a physical therapist in private practice, an occupational therapist in private practice, or a qualified speech language pathologist. So the first thing that you're going to need to scan and upload is going to be a copy of your letter from the IRS. It's the CP575. It's basically the letter that you received when you received your tax identification number. Now, an employer identification number, tax identification number, it's the same number. It's a 9-digit number, starts with 2 digits followed by a dash, and then the rest of the 7 digits. You will need to have that letter scanned and uploaded as a PDF document, preferably, for Medicare to consider your application. You'll also have to scan and upload a copy of a business check from your business banking account. Now, one of the things that hangs up a lot of applications is Medicare does not accept starter checks. They do not accept other forms of documentation. You basically have two options when you're setting up your EFT, which is required during the enrollment process. Either a business check from your business bank account, and the check must have your business information at the top left. It must have a check number at the top right corner, and that check number must show up down at the bottom next to the routing number and the account number. There should be some sort of indication of the name of the bank on your check, and you will handwrite void across the center of the check. So it's a scanned copy of a voided check. If you're unable to secure a copy of that check, you can get a letter from your bank. It needs to be on bank letterhead. It needs to be signed by a bank representative. It needs to indicate the business name, and that name must match the IRS letter, the IRS document CP575. The letter must have the fact that it is a business bank account. It must state that. It must state that it's a checking account or a savings account, and it must have the bank account routing number and account number. So that is an option. I've got sample letters that you can look at if you are still unsure of what exactly is required, but the best option is just have a business check, a real business check, not a starter check. You can buy them through your bank. You can buy them on Amazon for around $30. They're really pretty inexpensive, and you should have them for business operations into the future anyway. Once you have those two items, the IRS letter and the business check, the voided check, the next item you're gonna have is the CMS 460, which is the participating provider agreement. Now, typically I'll get that after I have your business MPI. And if you're using me to perform your contracting, I will go ahead and apply for your business MPI number. Once I receive that number, I'll put it on the CMS 460 application. I'll complete all the rest of the information, send that over to you for an original signature and the date. Those are the three documents required if you are only treating patients in the patient's home. If you're going to have a clinic, a physical clinic location where you're treating patients, I will also need to have a copy, a scanned copy of the lease, and the lease must indicate that you have exclusive use of the space if you're not renting the entire unit. So for example, quite a few clinicians might rent a room inside another facility. If that's the case, your lease has to indicate you're paying for fair market value, which room it is exactly that you're renting, and the fact that you have exclusive use of that area. It could be a room, it could be a 10 by 10 square in a larger area, but you have to have exclusive use for you and your patients during certain times. So some therapists will rent an area in a gym or a CrossFit gym or yoga studio, a 10 by 10 square in the northwest corner of the facility. They have exclusive use on Mondays and Wednesdays from 10 a.m. to noon. That's fine. It just has to be laid out like that in the lease. I need a scanned copy of that lease that I can upload during the application process. So once you have those three items for mobile PT, and then the fourth is the lease, if you're going to use a brick and mortar clinic, then the other information I'm going to need to secure from you, I need to know obviously an address, a telephone number, an email address. I'm going to need to know the full name of the institution where you graduated with your degree in either PT, OT, or SLP, and I need to know the year of graduation. Those are basically the five, sometimes six, components that I need to get either all of the application completed or most of it. I will do the research to find your license number and other information that's required for the process, but for now, I wanted you to know kind of what the basics are, what you need to get together to get the process going. Then what I'll do is I'll go ahead and send you a request to work on your behalf as either an authorized official or a surrogate through the Medicare INA system. And the way I do that is I'll take your personal MPI and I'll connect my Medicare INA account to your Medicare INA account. INA is an account that you should have already established, but if you haven't, no big deal, it's totally free. Do a Google search for Medicare INA, it's Identity and Access Management. And what you're gonna do is you're gonna go in there. Sometimes I've run into the situation where a therapist had somebody else create that account for them. Really shouldn't do it that way, but that's the way it's been done quite a bit. And so the therapist no longer has access to the account. You only get one account, it's connected to your personal social security number, so nobody else should have access to your account except you. So that's why it's imperative that if you can't access that account, call customer service on the Medicare INA website, get access to your account, because you're going to need to have that information moving forward into the future as you grow your business. So guys, I hope this little video was helpful. These are all the required documents and information that I'm going to need to get your enrollment either started or completed. And then once we're ready, I'll catch you in the next step of the process. Thanks for watching.